Welcome. The purpose of this video is to show you how to perform a recrystallization. This is going to be one of the important skills for you to master because the products that we make in the next two semesters, about two-thirds of them will be solids, and so this will be a necessary skill for you to master. The kind of recrystallization we're going to do is called a solution recrystallization. There are a couple other kinds, sublimation and melt crystallization, but this is our most common kind. And it's based on the fact that most solids are more soluble in a hot solvent than they are in a cold solvent. So essentially what we're going to do is we're going to dissolve a solid, in some boiling solvent and then allow the solution to cool and crystals should form. And as they form, the purpose is they will exclude impurities. In recrystallization, you hope that the impurities are one of two things, either insoluble in the hot solvent, in which case you could dissolve the solute that you're interested in and then perform a hot filtration and remove the impurities that are insoluble hot, or the more likely scenario is that you would have impurities that would have some solubility in the cold solvent, and so as the solute cools and crystallizes, the impurities are excluded from that crystal lattice when the crystals form slowly. So that's what we're after. An example of the first type might be, not that this would ever happen, but pretend you spilled your product on the lab bench and there was some sand from a sand bath on there and you didn't want the professor to know, and you scooped your product up, you saved the product, but now it had sand in it. How are you going to get the sand out of the product? Well, you would heat it up and do a hot filtration, and that would remove the sand because the sand wouldn't be soluble hot. But what we're going to do today is we're going to dissolve some benzoic acid in boiling water. That's the experiment that you'll be performing, and I'll show you how to do that. Now, before we get started, I want to talk a little bit about what kind of solvent are you going to choose for recrystallization. When you were back in general chemistry, you learned the saying that like dissolves like. Polar materials dissolve polar materials, nonpolar materials dissolve nonpolar materials, but that's not the phrase we want to use in recrystallization. What we're interested in, or our new phrase for recrystallization, is soluble hot, insoluble cold. If the material is soluble in cold solvent, it's not going to work. That solvent's not going to work as a recrystallization solvent because when you cool it, the material will still stay in solution. So I'm going to perform a couple of little test tube experiments and I hope give you the idea of how we would go about selecting a proper recrystallization solvent. All right, in this little experiment, we're going to recrystallize some benzoic acid. I don't know if you can see this, but our stock room has prepared a bottle of impure benzoic acid. Well, I'm going to use this as a model compound to demonstrate how you would select a solvent for recrystallization, an appropriate solvent. And I've picked four solvents, and we're just going to try these out. At this point, we don't know what's a good solvent for recrystallizing benzoic acid. Well, I do because I've done this experiment before, but you don't know. So how would you figure it out? We're going to provide you a lot of solvents and you would have to screen test these things. And here's the way you would do it. I've prepared four test tubes that have 150 milligrams of benzoic acid in the tubes. And then I've got four test tubes that have 2 milliliters of a particular solvent. And so we'll just go and see what happens, see how these would work as recrystallization solvents. So the two main criteria on a recrystallization solvent is the solvent cannot react with the compound. If it does, obviously that's no good. So these solvents will be non-reactive with benzoic acid. I'm pretty confident in that. Then the other main criteria is the benzoic acid needs to be soluble hot and insoluble cold. So if we put the benzoic acid in here at room temperature and it dissolves, this will not be an appropriate recrystallization solvent. So the first one I've selected is methyl alcohol. We'll often use methanol as a recrystallization solvent in some of our other experiments. So I'm going to take this 150 milligrams and dump this into the test tube with the methanol. well, maybe I'm going to put the methanol into that tube because I'm not having any luck getting it out of the tube. All right, so I'm going to mix this tube, and I like to do it just by smacking it with my finger. And now, can you see there's no white solid in the bottom of the tube? The solution's completely homogeneous. Well, like dissolved like. Not good for a recrystallization solvent because we need it to be insoluble cold. So methanol failed the test. Let's try dichloromethane. Here's a halogenated solvent. Doesn't look too much like benzoic acid. Maybe this will work. Let's see how this works. All right, smack it around a little. Oh boy, that went in right away. Can you see? There's no solid left. Methylene chloride didn't work either. We're 0 for 2. The next one is cyclohexane. So this is an alkane. This is about as nonpolar as you can get. We're going to put cyclohexane in with the benzoic acid. Try mixing it up. Not working. Well, that's good. That's good for our purposes because it appears insoluble cold. So let's see if it's insoluble hot. I've got a beaker of almost boiling water here. We'll put the test tube of the cyclohexane and benzoic acid into the hot water, and I'm going to agitate this a little bit. And when the cyclohexane boils, we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens to the benzoic acid. Solution's warming up. Looks like cyclohexane's beginning to boil. And I bring that out, and can you see? It's all dissolved. It's all dissolved at the high temperature. Ah, cyclohexane might work. I'm going to put that over here in the keeper box. And we're going to let that cool for a minute while we go to the last solvent. And the last one I picked was water. And usually water's not a very good solvent for most organic materials. Let's see how it works with benzoic acid. So here's 2 milliliters of DI water onto some benzoic acid. Stir, stir. Oh boy, that's not working at all. You can see that didn't work. All right, but that's good. That's good. So far, water's still in the race. Let's put water into the hot water bath and heat the water up and see what happens. Takes a minute for this to get hot. Also, I managed to slop a good bit of the benzoic acid up onto the wall, so I'll use a spatula to push it down into the tube. I can also use it to agitate the liquid that's down in the tube. The water boils at a higher temperature than the cyclohexane, so this is taking longer to come to a boil. The benzoic acid is dissolving. And if we get this hot enough, it should all dissolve. The water's boiling now, so we'll check the benzoic acid. It was almost all dissolved. Oh, you know what? We've got to watch this carefully. Watch when I pull this out. It will be homogeneous. In other words, just like water, water white and clear. And watch what happens when I pull it out. It's going to cloud up almost immediately. Do you see how fast that happens? The benzoic acid is going to crystallize out of the boiling water very rapidly. So I'm going to leave the benzoic acid there. Oh boy, that's on its way. Let's go back and have a look at that cyclohexane. You can see the cyclohexane is also clouding up. We're going to have crystals coming out of the cyclohexane in just a few minutes. Now what we'd like to have is, when you're doing a recrystallization, you want the solution to cool slowly. The idea is that the molecules are going to lay into a crystal lattice in a very orderly fashion. If we try to force the crystallization, a lot of beginning students like to take this hot solution and immediately put it into an ice bath, and that doesn't encourage crystallization, that encourages precipitation, and that's a rapid crystallization. And now the crystal is forming rapidly, and impurities that don't belong are getting incorporated back into the crystal lattice. So rapid cooling is no good. You want slow cooling. Let the crystals form slowly. Let the solution go to room temperature. You'll get nice crystals, and then we'll put it into some ice. By dropping the temperature, we'll decrease the solubility. That will force more crystals out of solution. So let's see where we are. Now, I'm kind of flicking this so we can get some of the crystals up onto the wall of the tube. I don't know if you can see that, but these are some pretty nice, they're small, but they're nice little crystals that are forming in the cyclohexane. So the cyclohexane is working. Look how much is coming out. Cyclohexane is working well as a recrystallization solvent for benzoic acid. And here is the one in water. This tube is still warm. I don't know how well you'll be able to see, but there's very nice needle-like crystals forming on the wall of the tube. So this is working really well. What we're going to do, or what you're going to do, and I'll demonstrate for you, we're going to do this recrystallization of benzoic acid on a larger scale, on a 1 gram scale, and we'll use boiling water. This is a good experiment when you're just learning the technique. So what I showed here is how you would screen for a good recrystallization solvent. We found one. Water will be a good one. You go, well, what's wrong with the cyclohexane? Cyclohexane is not bad, but here's the deal. In the end, when you put this into ice, to force more crystallization, the cyclohexane freezes above the temperature of water, boiling or freezing water. So this thing turns to an ice cube. So cyclohexane is not that great because the whole thing solidifies. All right, what we're going to do is, for the recrystallization of the benzoic acid, they want you to take 1 gram of benzoic acid. So I've already measured out the 1 gram. Here it is. They want you to use a 50 milliliter Erlenmeyer. So I'll see if I can get this in without putting too much of it on the bench. I'm going to have to use the spatula to scrape some of this. When you weigh out your benzoic acid, you want to record the mass to the nearest milligram, because in this experiment, we're going to see how much benzoic acid you recover. So you're putting in a gram. You're not going to get a gram out. There will be some loss. Even at very low temperature, there will be some solubility of benzoic acid in water. So it will not be 100% recovery. We want to measure that recovery. Anyway, this is something that you need to learn and accept. When we get a crude product, you'll have a certain mass of crude product, say 2 grams. You go to recrystallize it. If you get 1.5 grams back, you're probably doing well. All right, so here's the benzoic acid in the Erlenmeyer flask. They wanted 25 milliliters of DI water, and they said add 10. So we're going to add 10. More or less. Here we go. I've already done the calculation based on the solubility of benzoic acid in boiling water. It's going to take about 15 milliliters to dissolve all of this benzoic acid. So they said use 10. Okay, I'm using 10. I'm going to put this on what I hope is the still hot plate, and I'm going to swirl it around. I did not put a stir bar in here. I could have put the Could have put the small stir bar in here, and then I wouldn't have to do this with my hand. But either way, this needs some agitation. You don't want to leave this just sit on the hot plate with no agitation. Otherwise, this solution will bump and the boiling liquid will spray out. So make sure you give it some agitation. Now, what you're going to see, or what you are seeing now, not much is happening. Not much benzoic acid is dissolving because the solution's not warm yet. So I'm just going to continue to swirl, and in a minute or a few minutes, as this solution warms up, we'll see more and more of the benzoic acid dissolves. By the time the solution gets boiling, almost all of it will have dissolved. But I said I calculated it. I think we're going to need to add a few more milliliters. So when you're doing this with some other material, you don't know what the solubility is. You don't know how much solvent you're going to need. So you want to start small, bring the temperature to boiling, and then if all the solid has not dissolved, then you need to add more. So students are always asking, their common questions, how much solvent do I use? And here's the answer, the minimum amount. You want to use the minimum amount. What is that? I don't know. You do it. I don't know how much product you made. You do it. I don't know what the solubility is. Figure it out. Start small, get it to boiling, because if it's just warm, it doesn't count. Solvent needs to be boiling. Maybe you can see more and more of that benzoic acid has gone in. It's not boiling yet, but most of the benzoic acid has already dissolved. You gotta get this to boiling. Check it out. If there's still solid in there, we need to add a little more. Now you can see, I think, the water's boiling. Swirl, swirl. There's still solid in there, so I'm going to go in with a couple more milliliters. Now, when I added that extra water, the solution clouded up again. That was because I added cold water, so the temperature dropped suddenly, and the benzoic acid started to come out of solution because the temperature dropped. Now, it's boiling again, and you know what? I don't see any solid in there. I think we're good. I think we've added enough. Total was about, I added about, looks like about 19 milliliters. I'm letting a little of it boil off while I talk, but about 19 milliliters has all of that benzoic acid dissolved. Now watch closely, because this is going to happen pretty quickly. I take it off of the heat, and we're going to see that this is going to cloud up within a minute. This will be cloudy, and the crystals will start to form. So I think you can see it clouding up now. What we want to do at this point is just leave it sit quietly, let it cool to room temperature. Eventually we're going to put it in ice, but not now. Let it get to room temperature. Let the crystals form slowly. That's the best procedure. While this is going on, I'm going to just leave this here. While this is going on, I'm going to get ready for the next part of the procedure, which is going to be the vacuum filtration.